We have interesting news in Ukraine today. Not a surprise by any measure. This has been coming for quite some time. I think you all realize that. Russia has warned Porky and his pigs in Kiev, or Kiev as it is pronounced over there, against violating the Minsk II truce agreement. Of course, it's being violated every day. There are heavy artillery pieces now being moved by the right sector, which has declared war again on the east. So here it comes again. Kiev has also renounced completely the Minsk ceasefire. So what we have is war formally, although people aren't dying in any great numbers yet, having been declared again on the Eastern People's Republics, Luhansk and Donetsk, DPR and LPR. If Porky's orations about taking back Crimea are actually sincere, he's completely out of his mind. He'll be squashed like a bug. There are many ways to get rid of people. You don't have to defeat them on the battlefield. Trust me. In Russia Insider, let me read a little bit of this. We aren't necessarily going to talk about this, but I just wanted to bring you up to date. Predictably and right on cue as the date of the review of the European Union's sanctions on Russia approach, there is a major spike in the fighting in eastern Ukraine. This will come as a surprise to no one. As we have repeatedly said, the Ukrainians are not genuinely interested in implementing the terms of the Minsk Memorandum. Not genuinely interested is quite an understatement. Those terms, if implemented, would spell the end of the Maidan project. Not surprisingly, the Ukrainian government, which owes its entire existence to the Maidan project, will not willingly let it fail and will turn to war to prevent it from doing so. And as we have repeatedly said, quoting Russia Insider, recent indications Western support for Ukraine may be weakening simply to give Ukraine more reason to turn to war in the hope that this will rally Western Zionist support. Not a bad gamble. So what's happening is, as we predicted all along, the summertime offensive is about to begin. Lots of people are going to die. This is the ultimate effort to force Vladimir Putin to take military action against the West, which is full of special forces units from France, from Germany, probably, well, a number of European Union countries, certainly not the least of which is Great Britain. There are all kinds of foreign troops in there, and that really gives Kiev its fighting power. Without the foreign troops, they'd be nothing. They have a military that's a mess. So here we go. Just hang on, and you heard it here second. Maybe first, I don't know. We're going down to South America this hour to talk to Dr. Richard Sauder, our friend and colleague of, man, it's got to be close to 20 years. He is a remarkable man in many ways, and always glad to talk to him. Hi, Richard. Welcome back.
Hello, Jeff. Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
I think we can both say that. Jeez.
Listen, with respect to the Ukraine, you know, the government in Kiev could not possibly hang on if it didn't have backing from NATO and the United States. And the events that are coming up later this year in the time frame of October, September, and October are going to rock the United States. And that means that going forward, even starting, say, 120 days from now or so, support by the United States and or by NATO for the regime in Kiev, which is a rogue regime by definition, that support is very possibly going to vanish or be greatly weakened.
Right.
Putin knows this. And so he's laying back. He's kind of adopting the Muhammad Ali strategy of rope-a-dope. He's biding his time. I'm not sure that we will see a an entry by the regular Russian army.
Don't think it'll be needed, to tell you the truth. But
yeah. No, they'll just wait for the NATO, the European Union, and the United States to
commit themselves
for their karmic debt. Perfect. To come due, and they are about to come due in a major way.
Agreed. Very well said. Here's another one. Hacked emails, I mean, many of you saw this at Rense last week, hacked emails have exposed George Soros as Ukraine's puppet master. He and Porky have been emailing fervently back and forth, planning and trying to make all kinds of contingencies. It's a remarkable story. Let me read just a little bit of this to you. Just days after George Soros warned that World War III was imminent, boy, if he has anything to say about it, I guess it will be, unless Washington backed down to China on IMF currency basket inclusion, boy, these people play the angles. The hacker collective Cyber Burkut has exposed the billionaire as the real puppet meister behind the scenes in Ukraine. In three stunning documents allegedly hacked from email correspondence between the hedge fund manager and Ukraine's president, Porky Porkoshenko, Soros lays out, quote, a short and medium-term comprehensive strategy for the new Ukraine, expresses his confidence that the U.S., in fact, should provide Ukraine with lethal military assistance, as if it already hasn't, with the same level of sophistication in defense weapons to match the level of opposing force. And finally explained, Porkoshenko's first priority must be to regain control of financial markets, which he assures the president could be helped by the Fed. That's right, the Federal Reserve, adding, quote, this is Soros, I am ready to call Jack Lew of the U.S. Treasury to sound him out about the swap agreement. So, again, the level of criminality, it knows no bounds. These people are incredible.
Well, the onion has many layers, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
And but it's all about to come to an end. I believe that this knowledge is certainly well known to the movers and shakers in what I have come to start calling Mordor on the Potomac, and it's orc horde, Pentagon orc horde.
Well said.
The Pentagon is about to release its orcs on the American homeland, especially the southern tier of states and Southwest, and they are going forth, I believe. Probably in some force as this Jade Helm exercise wears on. It appears initially it'll be more like show the flag, public relations exercise. See, your army is here. They're nice boys and girls. Don't be alarmed. They're just practicing.
They won't put a bullet through your head. Don't worry.
Yes, and there'll be lots of flag waving and playing of patriotic anthems. You can count on that.
Oh, yeah.
But later, as things get more serious moving into September and October, my belief is that these troops could be used for genuine military activities, perhaps against the American people or certain segments of the American people. I, by no means, am alone in that assessment. Now, the thing is that the dollar is crashing. I've mentioned this in my blog post now for some time. Mm-hmm. I even put up a graphic in one of my recent blog posts that shows how many hundreds of billions of dollars of international trade are now not being done with the American dollar. In the past, these hundreds of billions of dollars worth of international deals would have been taking place in the American dollar, but countries all over the world are abandoning the dollar for international trade and using their own respective currencies for bilateral trade. This is having an effect. It's, to use a boxing analogy again, this is a heavy body blow, because the dollar has its value owing to its wide use as the primary international reserve currency for most of the world post-World War II period. That status is now being rapidly eroded, very rapidly. And trade that now runs to the hundreds of billions of dollars internationally will very soon run into the trillions of dollars. In other words, the world has seen the dollar and has called its bluff and is taking its business elsewhere. Mm-hmm. So the dollar is like any other product. Its product is physically printed up by the train car load or just manufactured out of thin air with keystrokes on mainframe computers.
You bet.
But the dollar is a commercial product, and it's like any other commercial product. When it falls out of favor, it loses market share. When the United States dollar, what's called the United States dollar, in reality is a United States Federal Reserve Bank note, and that's not the same thing as the United States dollar, but for the purposes of this conversation right now, let's pretend it's the United States dollar, and it's rapidly losing market share. Well, that matters because the petrodollar, mm-hmm. which was implemented by Richard Nixon in the early 1970s, when he took the dollar off of any tie to gold and silver for once and for all, when it loses market share, the whole political economic system that the United States has spent most of the past century building will lose its force, lose its influence. That will be the end of the so-called United States of America, whatever that means, as a global power.
Whatever it means,
I don't know what it means. What does it mean?
I don't know.
Anyway,
I don't know.
When that, and they know this is happening, by they, I mean the leadership, the hierarchy, power hierarchy at the Federal Reserve, in the major United States federal agencies,
uh-huh.
at the Pentagon, in the executive office of the president, colloquially called the White House. All of these agencies know that the game is up, the jig is up, and I've said that in my recent blog posting. So what are they going to do?
Uh-huh.
They will do what tyrants and empires have always done for centuries. They will try to maintain their power and control by military means. It never works. It always fails. But fading, dying empires and tyrants always resort to military force in extremis. And they go down anyway. And that's what's about to happen to the United States. Well, the Pentagon knows this is coming. And right about in the time frame, or just before, that the Chinese are rumored to going to issue their new Chinese gold-backed currency. We see this jade helm exercise. Now, when the Chinese, who have unknown thousands of tons of pure gold sitting in their vaults. No one knows how many thousands of tons of gold the Chinese have.
Right.
And they're not saying. But safely, even from publicly known data, it's known that it's a lot. And when they do what they appear to be ready to do in about 120 days from now, mm-hmm. and issue their gold-backed Chinese national currency, that will pretty well put paid to this little scrap of worthless paper called the United States dollar.
Well, we better learn how to pronounce the word yuan pretty soon.
Yeah, and maybe get some of them for your own use.
Oh, they'll start appearing. You watch in the Chinese American communities. You'll see them. It'll begin to spread around from there. It's whatever is perceived to be worthy and have value will be used as currency, and the yuan will have probably its place staked out at the top of the heap.
Well, if it's backed by gold, for sure, because as we've seen the United States dollar right now. I mean, maybe you have one. I have a $5 bill in my pocket. It's the only $5 bill I have presently.
I'll give you $1 for it.
I like it for that reason alone.
Uh-huh.
It's a piece of paper.
Yeah.
It's got a picture of Abraham Lincoln on it, and it says, let's read the fine print. This note is legal tender for all debts, public and private, which means it says at the top, Federal Reserve note, it says $5, and it also has printed on it the United States of America. But the fact that it says this note is legal tender for all debts, public and private, means essentially it's a sort of debt instrument.
That's right. That's exactly what it is. Sure.
It's a debt instrument. It's not really currency.
No.
A debt instrument is not currency. A debt instrument is kind of like a chit that says...
It's an IOU.
Exactly. And so when this realization is sinking in all around the world, big time, especially among the Chinese and Russians and others. So when it finally fails, we'll all say, well, you know, I got $5, I've got $10. And the response to that will be, so what? It's a piece of paper with Abraham Lincoln's face on it and nothing more.
Weimar Germany paper. Yeah.
Well, maybe not even worth that much, Jeff, because what is coming is going to be so bad. I don't think a lot of the American people and a lot of people in Britain have wrapped their heads around what is coming. It's going to be brutal.
I mean, you're right, Richard, and honestly, how can they? When they live in a world where they're drowning in media garbage and crap, and the top story of the day is, I won't mention it.
Please don't.
No, I didn't. I promised you I wouldn't. This is really grim. I mean, it's just grim.
It is. And you know, I've mentioned this before, I think, on your show and certainly in my blog, that I was forewarned of all of this in substance, maybe not in extreme detail, but at least in broad outline, by the apparition or the entity who appeared to me on the roof of the family home when I was 3 years old, and whom I called the Bone Lady. The Bone Lady revealed to me that a terribly dark, grim time was coming. And look around you. It's settling in right now as we speak in 100 different ways all over the world. And she also revealed to me that although this time was coming, it didn't necessarily have to be that way or this way. If human beings were to raise their consciousness, and what she communicated to me, and both of these made a very major impact on me and have had a lot to do with my life career, as unorthodox as it has been. But the other thing she revealed to me was that, you know, it's possible, I don't know if for every single human being, but I think for an awful lot, thousands, maybe millions or more, to develop a very high level of consciousness and awareness, essentially like Jesus or Jesus-like or like the Buddha, to be substantially self-aware and self-realized and, I guess the word is, cosmically conscious. Mm-hmm. In other words, vastly different than the run-of-the-mill human being of today. But suffice it to say, the vast majority of humans on the planet right now have not chosen to go that route.
No, we came upon the Y in the road, and we were forcibly directed to the wrong one.